Hello and welcome to the session now. Basically, it's the second part of the radio wave propagation where we're actually going to test and listen to some shortwave reception. It is in the middle of the afternoon in Cape Town, South Africa, and because I've managed to kind of track down the sources of noise which were causing me problems during the day, we can actually listen to some shortwave during the day, which is great. Well, I'll probably repeat another session like this at night because that will bring out some interesting differences in signal strength and the number of stations that we can receive, what have you. What we're going to do, we're going to focus on basically two frequencies that the BBC World Service is operating on at the moment. There's a few things we're going to cover off. The one prime reason for doing this was to do a review of this KPO or the KTO WR2100 shortwave radio. We're going to do a comparison and just look at my FT950 as well, my Yaesu FT897 we'll listen to as well, and my Yaesu FRG7000. We're going to switch between the normal built-in antenna on the radio, a wire antenna, and an end-fed dipole. I've got all the switching down here so we can do that. Also, what I'll do, I'll be able to switch the audio through the speaker, so to try and equal things out, because these radios have different speakers facing a different direction, so the audio, as I said, the audio is important, and to try and equal things out, for the most part, we're going to try and use a single speaker. You'll have to bear with me, this could be quite a challenging video, because obviously the strength of the frequency and what's going to happen from time to time could vary. But anyway, it'll just be a little bit of an intro and we can see what the radios produce. And I'll give you some pros and cons about the radios and kind of my favorites and what have you. So let's jump in. Before we jump in, what I'm going to do, I'm going to take you outside quickly just to quickly show you again the antennas that we're using. And then we'll jump in here and start. Okay, and just to show again, I did show this in a previous video. But what are we going to be using today? You can see this black line coming out. It's going out and over the top of the garage over there. This is my end-fed dipole. It has been both of these wires, and I'll just show you the other one. This is literally a piece of wire of random length, which is just strung up along the side of the house, and in fact is jammed into a bathroom window over there. Both these two antennas have been strung up without much regard at all, and that's part of the exercise. It's a case of just seeing if you sling an antenna up, what can it do for you? And in a future video we'll actually get where we get a bit more fussy about how we set up our antenna, tuning them, and the direction we put them in. Okay, so before we get stuck in, what I also wanted to bring to your attention is that there are several sites, or there are loads of sites on the internet which can be really helpful in terms of understanding both for ham radio users who are kind of looking for where people are transmitting and what have you. But for this exercise, we're going to look at a site which kind of shows shortwave information, and it's called short-wave.info. I'll put the address in the show notes so you've got it there. But basically what it does, you can either search for frequencies by kind of station, or you can input a frequency that you're listening to find out what service it is. And at the moment, I have in the two frequencies of the BBC World Service. The one is at 21470 kilohertz. That happens to be this site. I don't know if you'll see it. I'll zoom in a little bit to see if you can see the info, but I'll read it out to you. That site happens to be in Mahé, if I pronounce it correctly, which I believe is the Seychelles. So that's a little way off from where I am. We are obviously down here at the tip of Africa. That's a little way off. Then the other frequency we will listen to is 12095 kilohertz. And again, you probably can't see that, but I've put it in there, 12095 kilohertz. And believe it or not, that is sitting in a town in the north of South Africa, a town called Meyerton. Now this site is quite nice because what it does, in the information, it actually tells you the location, which direction the antenna is pointing, and the power. The Meyerton signal is being broadcast at 100 watts. The other signal is being broadcast at 250 watts. So all those various factors, the power and the direction of the antenna, obviously have an influence on the way you're going to receive and the strength that you're going to receive the signal. So we'll pop over now to the radios quickly. I'll just quickly describe some of the radios to you and then we'll get on and do some listening. Okay, so first what we're going to do, I've got the KPO WR2100 tuned into 21470. I'm going to turn up the volume. That signal, basically at the moment, the way I've got it set up, if I remember correctly, I have that set up through the built-in antenna, which I have got extended up to where I could find the best signal. And let me just double check. Yeah, so currently I've got the switch set to internal, which means it is using that antenna. Now I currently have my antenna switch set to the wire antenna for when I switch over to the external. So let's just see if we can pick up a difference. And I say sometimes it's difficult to actually tell the difference because the signal actually wanes in and out. So that's back to the telescopic antenna. And that's to the wire. Now sometimes actually the telescopic at the moment seems to be producing a fairly good result. That obviously sometimes changes at night. Where we'll repeat this, where obviously that piece of wire can do amazing things. Okay, now what I'm going to do, I'm going to switch back to the external antennas and switch between that wire and the NFED dipole. That's nothing. That's the dipole. Back to the wire. And I picked up here that on this higher frequency, that piece of wire is actually sometimes outperforming the dipole. And there's a logical explanation for that. That piece of wire is shorter than the NFED dipole, so it is going to perhaps be better at the higher frequencies. Let's just double check that quickly. There's a few other things on this radio I want to point out. At the moment, I've got it set to narrow band, which does some filtering for noise. Let's listen.
And the second aside that no matter what happens today, they're going to keep the pressure up because they see it as a useful tool.
Now, the signal at the moment is fairly clean.
Not doing what it says.
But later we'll try that, and we'll see that that narrowing can help a lot.
We're trying to secure reform. We want to talk to people. We cannot do that in an atmosphere of...
Okay, what I'm going to do next, I'm going to switch down to the other frequency that the BBC World Service is operating on, and again, play around with the antennas. I'm going to go to narrow. I'll turn up the volume, and I'll do the switch between the frequencies first of all. Wide, narrow.
There are plenty of words about working together, but what might that mean in practice? Let's hear first from
And again, what I want to highlight is that sometimes the one frequency is working better than the other, and that is obviously to do with just changing conditions in the atmosphere. Even though the one antenna or broadcast is a lot closer to my location, sometimes the more distant broadcast actually comes through clearer. Okay, I'm going to switch to the telescopic. I'm switching between the telescopic and the wire, not too much difference. This is the end-fed dipole. And you can hear there's a fair bit more noise.
We are willing and ready to continue to engage in exchange and dialogue with all fields, including the human rights field.
The end-fed dipole there seems to certainly play a part and provide a better signal. But I say the signal's fading in and out.
But it's not only European countries. Your relationship with China is crucial. Later, the man expects to become the next Chinese leader.
Okay. So now what we're going to do is just do, I must say it. The one thing I really do enjoy about this radio is it does have a nice, good quality front-facing speaker. The analog volume adjustment is really great. And being able to change the treble and bass really means you can get an audio sound which suits your own ear.
Eurozone crisis, economic interdependence is at the forefront of concern. Chinese wariness over EU and US calls for financial assistance and policy shifts is balanced by concern in Beijing over the impact of Western economic tribulations on China's own growth prospects.
Okay. So now I'm going to just position myself a little differently so it's easier for me to switch, but we're going to switch between the FT950 and that radio just to get a comparison. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is basically switch, I've got my antenna switch set up so that I switch the signal between either the consumer radio, the KPO, or the FT950. The FT950 audio comes out here, and obviously this audio comes out here. So I'm going to go first through to the KPO.
Could also affect the shipment of iPads from China, where the tablet computer is made.
That's the FT950.
You're listening to World Briefing here on the BBC World Service with me, Andrew Peach. And still to come,
KPO.
The government responds to the possibility
of stripped of its AAA credit. 950. I see this as a reality check to the whole political system.
And indeed the whole country, the Britain has to confront its debt problem.
And the British government is doing precisely that.
Today's main story, the growing violence in Shia villages outside the Bahraini capital of Manama.
As opponents of the government tend to mark the first anniversary of
So what I just wanted to again highlight with that, basically is to say this, on AM, this KPO seems to actually do really well in comparison with my kind of top end or fairly top end FT950. Now we have to bear in mind that obviously for this test we're not the 950. It would see its advantage once you really string to put together a good antenna and you're looking at weak signals and single sideband and that kind of thing. So it's not to say that there's anything wrong with the 950 and that this consumer radio gives the FT950 a good run for its money. On AM, the Yaesu basically SA has been hamstrung perhaps a bit by the antenna, and its strength would come in for when the signals start getting a lot weaker, because it's far more sensitive and you can start playing with filters and what have you to bring out a strong signal. But nonetheless, just listening to the shortwave AM broadcast just shows you that this KPO unit certainly doesn't do too badly at all. Okay, so now what I'm going to do, I'm going to play around with the antenna switches to switch between the FT950, the Yaesu FT897, and my FRG7000. I will note as I've switched between the radios which radio I've switched to. You'll have to excuse, there's a bit of hand and eye coordination here to get the audio and the right antenna switched through. But just again, just to give a rough comparison between the three. Let's jump in and do that. First, I'm going to set up and this is the FT9. This is the FT950.
Continue, but it won't be on the agenda. And House of Commons sessions, lawmakers still pray that
this is the Yaesu FT897.
but attendance at the prayers is voluntary. Britain's second chamber, the House of Lords, still contains...
That is FRG 7000.
...in education, worries about standards have boosted the popularity...
I'm going to flick quickly between the 7000 and the 897, because that's easy to do.
...their religious beliefs. Secularists argue that religious schools indoctrinate children and divide communities.
7,000.
Attendance at mainstream churches at least is small and declining and should play no part, they say, in public life. For others, secularism is a necessary bulwark against religious fundamentalism of all types. So the real divide then is between those who believe the altruistic 7,000. Aspects of faith outweigh the divide.
I'm going to go back up to the 950.
That Britain is an inclusive country. And having a high-profile British Muslim argue that Europe needs to be more comfortable, its Christian identity sends a message in itself. The British government has been defending...
Now, for the most part, they're not too far off. The audio, I think, on the coming out of the 950... would kind of make one think that its reception is not that clear, but there are many, many settings you can do to kind of change the audio on the 950, which is something I want to bring up once I go through, let's say, the tuning on my 7000 and something like the 950. And the reason I want to kind of bring this into play is someone sent me an email and was asking about what kind of receiver or transmitter they should get kind of starting off if they're getting into kind of amateur radio and shortwave listening and what have you. And they were talking about perhaps either getting a good receiver, and I kind of pointed them in the direction of, I know ICOM do some nice shortwave receivers, or getting a transmitter. And in my mind, there's certainly no harm starting with a very basic good receiver. And I'm going to bring your attention to my FRG 7000. We'll get closer so that I can kind of demonstrate this radio and how I set and reception. So I'm going to switch down to it.
Des, we as a government are not going to waver in our commitment.
The audio quality that comes out of its own front speaker is really, really good. It's very difficult to even try and do a comparison, especially obviously taking into account the audio quality that's going to come into the camera. The best way to do a test yourself is actually to have a set of headphones, because these sound very different once you put a pair of headphones on your ears, and because then you kind of lose the tinniness or the inadequacies of a speaker if you've got a good set of headphones and you can listen to the signal that way. And unfortunately, I can't really demonstrate that for you, but take it as, you know, try it for yourself and you'll soon realize. But this Yaesu FRG 7000 really is a beauty for picking up both ham and shortwave reception. It's very basic, but yet still a very good receiver. And it allows you to train your ears and learn the basics about antennas and reception. And I'll just demonstrate that for you. I mean, if I'm going to turn up the audio, I'm going to take it off frequency. It's got this little the knob over here, which takes you through the main megahertz tuning. On the side here, you'll see, I'm going to try and get you a little bit closer so you can see what I'm doing. It actually has a built-in antenna tuner, which shows you the different bands. You flick between, this is obviously your inductor you're setting over here to basically tune in either your piece of wire or your antenna. You set the inductor to the band that you're on, and then you've got this, what they call pre-selector, which should be adjusting at the capacitance. It's got a nice analog S unit to basically measure the strength of your incoming signal. Nice clear display. It's got a mode switch from lower sideband, upper sideband, AM, and then AM with some noise limiting on it. And then a tone and volume switch. So we'll go up back to 21 megahertz. Okay, it's got a fine tune over here as well. As you can see, that changes, gives you about a one or two change on your least significant digit on your frequency. So we'll take it back up to, and now I'm going to flick the selector up to the band. Now have a look at the strength meter here.
Is that these children will be on the same level playing field as every other child in America. We know this will happen because they're in such survival.
So I'm going to turn down the audio, but you can both, using your ear and your eye, soon see very easily, and in fact I can just do it with my eye, by looking at that strength meter, when I've hit the sweet spot of the best signal. And that is the beauty about this very analog radio in effect. All the controls you need are on the front, there's no tucked away menus, there are no memories, so you have to do everything manually. And that is such, in my opinion, is such good training if you really want to get into radio listening. And one of the biggest strengths of doing amateur radio is tuning your ears and understanding how to pick up a signal and what have you. And in my mind, if you kind of start off with an advanced radio like the FT950, it's a lovely radio. But my goodness, it has got so many features and filters and what have you. It's got a menu system with everything tucked away, so it can be really challenging. You have to be well practiced and rehearsed to use this radio well. That's why these radios tend to get, besides all the fancy signal processing and filters and what have you that these radios have, they get more expensive. Like the bigger brothers of this 950 have a lot of the features which are tucked away on the menus come out on buttons and controls, which again makes them far easier to operate. As if you're into doing competition radio, that's what you need, because to get to your settings via menu system if you're in a competition can hamstring you a bit. I'm not and as I said, I'm not a practicing ham at the moment. I never really got into competition, but I used to listen on competition days, and certainly you want easy access to be able to fine-tune your reception and your filtering and what have you. And this is something nice to graduate to once you've tuned your ears on a good receiver. And that's where I say, I don't know that you're easily going to find an older radio like this, but I would always keep an eye open for a nice simple receiver like this.
As opponents of the government attempt
to market. This radio, I think, was brought out in the 1980s, if I remember correctly. I received it in the 1980s. I can remember at the time, there was a step up from this. There was the Yaesu FRG 7700, which had FM and had liquid crystal displays and what have you. And I really wanted that, but this is what I ended up with. And I tell you what, I have no regrets, because this is a fine receiver, and it really teaches you the basics. So easy to tune in and brings in a good signal. Okay, so this is my Yaesu FT897. This is the radio I bought when I first got my technician's license in the States. It's a fairly versatile radio because it offers all the modes. You've got HF, VHF and UHF, so you can do repeater work and HF work. It allows you to operate at home. It's a fairly portable device, so you can go into the field and connect it up to a 12 volt power source. It's got a nice tuning knob. It's got very basic noise reduction and what have you, but certainly none of the fancy filtering and what have you that something like the 950 has, but it's a totally different class. It certainly is a nice radio to start off on. I had some very fun moments when I first started chatting to people in Florida and what have you, and we'll do a session where I kind of talk about where I first got started and the antenna that I first used and what you can do with certain limiting factors like living in a condo or what have you. But that we'll cover off in another session. But I'll just turn up the volume.
Said the Chinese government had the interests of the Syrian people at heart, and its priority was to prevent war and chaos in Syria. The authorities in Gaza say the Palestinian terrorists...
And you can see this is bringing in actually a really nice signal at the moment. I'm just going to switch between the wire and the NFED. We're on the NFED at the moment. It's the wire. We can see the strength meter over here. Sorry, I see this thing has gone a bit blurry. Just give you a closer look at the strength meter there. We're on the wire antenna, NFED, and it's not making too much difference, to tell you the truth. The signal is actually fairly crisp at the moment. It's got on here, you can actually bring up soft keys for menu functions at the moment. I've got them set to kind of some of the noise reduction. And these filtering bits and pieces, especially when you start listening to weak signals on upper or lower sideband, can be very helpful. Even on this radio, which has got limited kind of signal processing.
And on Valentine's Day, our office emails can turn to romance. The reply comes back. As scented and perfumed, she has typed, "I'm fine. Oh, hate Mondays, love. How about you?"
And what I'm going to do quickly is just also demonstrate the whole feature of using your audio gain and your signal gain. You've got a volume switch here, and you can see basically I'm reducing the amplification of the incoming signal. And if we had a noisy signal, you can do that, reduce it to clear out the noise, and then turn up the audio to try and get that part of the signal that you want to listen to. And again, I'll be able to demonstrate this far better at night when we try and search for some weaker signals.
Same shock absorbers as before. Shock absorbers being the ability to, you know.
Okay, I've moved up to the FT950.
Government spending and so forth, isn't it, to stimulate their own economies.
And as you can see at the moment, I've been listening to this broadcast for much of the afternoon, and the signal's kind of been fluctuating in and out. Perhaps we're moving to a time of day when the conditions are getting a little better. I'll just play around with a little bit of the adjustments that you can do to kind of change a signal.
And what happened in the first phase of the financial crisis was
there's a contour where you can either reduce some of the audio qualities of the incoming signal or increase them.
Then the dip this time around won't be as bad for the commodity producer as it was in your age of mind. I'm concerned about the commodity producer or country. We are concerned about those.
You can switch off contouring. You can change the width of the filter width. And this is where you can kind of enhance some of the audio.
Last few months, but it was quite volatile, about 6 months ago. Those are the kind of things that you see, which are constantly
to suit your ear.
Do you think Africa gets some benefit from the fact that it's perhaps not so...
You then have loads of other features in terms of the signal processing as it comes through the radio, selecting which antenna, attenuation... And at the moment with this signal, you're not noticing too much difference. But again, when we do a session in the evening, we'll play with that. It's obviously got two separate, you can have a separate receive end and transmit end. So if you've got a split transmit and receive, you can actually do that on this radio. But as I say, even myself at the moment, I haven't been actively using this radio for a while. And it's a bit of a challenge trying to put in a signal correctly if you're not fully au fait with what's tucked away in the menu systems, because that is the strength of the radio. What you can adjust, you can really, really fine-tune this to bring in a good radio signal and good audio. But you need to know which buttons to push, what to twiddle with, because you can send things totally out if you don't do it correctly. But that's the complication, and it's why I certainly wouldn't advise someone starting out to get a radio like this, because there's some good basics you're going to pick up from a basic radio that can get lost if you start jumping into something that's too advanced. It's something certainly nice to think about moving up to, but starting with a good basic radio, I think, is a good way to start. Okay, and just to finish off, back to this old capo.
But isn't a huge political risk in countries that have democracy that's either shaky or non-existent?
The spread of democracy has been quite steady in Africa. So, and the political risks have dropped significantly. Africa is really hurt by the perception that the risk is very high. We have found through a long time investing there and a variety of investments in countries.
Yeah, I'm playing with the AMRF gain.
Africa is one of the few places where that's not awash with money and people looking for deals. So it allows us to invest in excellent companies with much less competition.
But for my mind, I must say, this radio, if you're into your shortwave listening and what have you, certainly works well and has got a lot of, if you look at the review that I did, it's got a lot of features and functionality for a good shortwave listening radio. I love the analog controls and what have you. It is a little bit limited in terms of the memories it's got. And its search function, in terms of you can't directly key in a frequency. You have to use a dial, but you have got a slow and a fast feature to get you there. If you're kind of the more lazy type of person who would just like to, if you're traveling and you want to pick up a signal and not have to search around, then the little gem that we're going to review soon, this Texan PL398, has got some really good surprises up its sleeve. But that will come in a future video. What I'm going to do now, I'll just lead you into what we will cover off. As I say, we'll do another session at night where we can get more into the shortwave listening. The one reason I did this during the day, as I said, it's a little bit easier to me to kind of rattle on a bit because I'm not disturbing anyone. But we'll do this, repeat this again at night, but I'll just lead you into what will be coming in some future videos. Okay, so as I said, I hope you gained a little bit of value out of that. It's certainly, I think, once we do a session at night, that we'll be able to yield a little more difference in terms of what the different antennas can do and the different receivers can do. Hopefully it was a little bit of an introduction to what's there. What we will do, as I said, is for one, perhaps have a general chit-chat about how I got into ham radio, the limitations I had to deal with living in a condo, and how I strung up antennas, and that'll kind of lead into also us putting together and building homebrew antennas, because it's amazing what you can achieve with some very simple bits and pieces. With that antenna, to say, the key thing is having an antenna analyzer which can help you. And here I've got a kind of UHF antenna that I put together, and all it is one of these antenna connectors with some thick copper insulated copper wire, which is soldered into the top here, And then what you do, although I've only got one, you get four, you have radials which you mount on there. And with your antenna tuner, you can build a very simple homebrew antenna for doing repeater work. And you don't have to go to the expense of buying some fancy antenna in a shop. Something else which I put together, this is simply a tub with coaxial cable wrapped around it with the antenna connector inside, simple PVC pipe on the top, and then you'll see I've got these wires, two wires either side, and this used to be strung in my attic in the condo when I was in the States. So there's long bits of copper wire, although it's all tangled up. I'll give you a better look at this with some insulators at the end. And this I used to use for both 20 meter and 10 meter work. And again, it's surprising what you can achieve with even something homebrew like this. And I'll go through the construction with you and show you what the antenna analyzer can show. Because what we'll do, we'll put this together, and as opposed to those silly ad hoc pieces of wire which I've chucked out the window, which I've done for a purpose to show you what you can achieve by just putting a piece of wire out the window, we'll then try and refine things and get better reception by playing around with some of these homebrew antennas and seeing what they can achieve. Anyway, I look forward to you joining me again for another session. If you have gained any value out of this, please do give it a thumbs up. And if you think there's anyone else that may enjoy this series, then certainly please do share it with them or subscribe. Thanks very much for watching.